आपने एक्चुअली एक अच्छा ग्राउंड रूल रख दिया इस सेशन के लिए. दिस सेशन इज अ क्लास विदाउट लेसन प्लान, राइट? सो देर इज नो लेसन प्लान, देर इज नो प्रेशर फ्रॉम एनीबडी दैट आई हैव टू कंप्लीट अ सर्टन करिकुलम. यू ब्रिंग वॉट एवर दैट्स देयर ऑन योर माइंड इन टर्म्स ऑफ, वी नो ऑर्गेनाइजेशन, इंक्लूजन, डूइंग बेटर. वी हैव डन हाउ मेनी टीम बिल्डिंग सेशंस हैव ईच वन ऑफ यू अटेंडेड? अ लॉट, है ना? बहुत सारे सेशंस ऐसे अटेंड किए हैं जिसमें वी हैव टॉक्ड अबाउट माइंड, हाउ वी आर फीलिंग, वी शुड हैव बेटर टीम्स, वी शुड हैव स्ट्रॉन्गर टीम्स, इंडिविजुअली आई शुड डू बेटर, दैट विल रिफ्लेक्ट इन ऑर्गेनाइजेशन, दैट विल रिफ्लेक्ट इन सोसाइटी. वी हैव हर्ड ऑल ऑफ दिस, राइट? वेयर डू वी फील अबाउट इट? वॉट डू वी फील अबाउट इट? वेयर आर वी इन टर्म्स ऑफ दैट? आर वी ऑल परफेक्ट इन अ ग्रेट प्लेस इन आर ऑर्गेनाइजेशंस? ऑल ऑफ अस आर फ्रॉम इंटरसेक्शन हियर? नो. ओके, विच ऑल ऑर्गेनाइजेशंस आर देयर? Many? Yeah. Okay. So when you introduce or talk, can you just also tell which organization are you from? Sure. It will help me understand.
I'm from Indus Action.
Okay.
And I think, I mean, Indus Action has a lot of principles to make it an inclusive space, it's a space that we try to keep safe. We it's a place that we try to lead create as students try to keep psychologically safe, to fail, to make mistakes, to decide each other. So that's what the
fantastic. Okay. And where are the areas where you think that you can put more work? Which are some of the areas? Yeah, as a part of the team.
I don't know. I mean, I'm still learning. I'd like to take more initiative, do more things. I've just gone in this action 2 months ago.
So okay. Possibly, okay.
Yeah, take more initiative.
Okay. Anything else, anyone?
I'm from Indus. Actually, inclusive actually has different definitions for different people.
Sure.
I think to get to a common understanding of what inclusive is, I think that's always a struggle, because what is inclusive to me might not be, let's say, inclusive for another person.
Sure. Okay. And even in, sometimes do we also feel that despite best intentions of being inclusive, the goal is sometimes like we are not able to meet that objective always. Does that happen to some of us, that the intention is, oh, yes, sir?
I'm Pratik. I'm from Beach Point. Basically, what you're saying, our goal is, like, what we think, are we able to achieve that or not? But again, the success is different for different perspectives.
Sure.
If I'm teaching a student, for him or her, getting a good grade is a success. And for me, like, getting him a CD, UWC, or any other good school is a success. So again, inclusive is matching those or resonating those ideas to get the.
Sure. Okay. Anything else? Anything new? Anything different from what we have already heard? Yes.
I'm Shantan, Speech for India. And so I've worked in this space for barely a year. I don't know much at all. But I feel that with like-minded people, that inclusiveness, that safe space automatically gets built. What I'm looking to maybe gain more insight on is maybe how to preserve that spirit, that culture, that safe space when there are diverse group of people with different interests and when you're scaling.
Sure.
Because in my area of work, I've come with these, whenever that was getting stretched, it was because of one of these or all three of these taking at the same time. When there are different people and maybe they were different things, that's why they have different aims as well. And of course, when you scale, then everything just, you know, kind of condenses and everything just maybe becomes a mess. Maybe
the
insight from
those
guys.
Sure. Yeah.
Satyam from Indus Action. I would like you to talk about the safe space. This is such an overused word. I was a Gandhi fellow before, used every other day. I have not still figured out what the meaning of safe space is. So I'd like to talk.
Fantastic. About. Okay. We'll talk a little bit about then, drawing on what our fellow friend from Teach for India said, a little bit about what are the different components that keep inclusion as a ongoing pursuit and not as a one-time thing, that now we became inclusive, now let's freeze it and let's move on. No, one is of course safe spaces, part of that, pretty much a part of that. What do we really mean by safe spaces? How do we create them?
So I'm Chris, I'm from Indus Action. I resonate with what Mayur just said, but what is inclusion? Is it about accepting differences or is it about everyone being the same?
Sure. Okay. Fantastic. Okay, so what does inclusion really mean itself? Okay, as we know, just to sort of keep the discussion moving, feel free to add at any point. one important part when we talk about inclusion, I'm coming today from the entirely different sort of psychological perspective to that, right? So I'm looking at the mind side of it. There are lots of different goals each one of us are trying to achieve in terms of inclusion. We are trying to make society more just, we are trying to make it more sustainable, we are trying to make it more growth oriented, we are looking at development as the three goals of this entire exercise itself. We are looking at people getting access to the rights which are already given to them. We are playing a role in them getting those rights, a whole bunch of different things, right? And then within that, we are also saying that our organization should be inclusive. Then what do we, how do we understand this? How do we make sense of it? So right now, in this entire session, we'll make a conscious practice to talk about inclusion, talk about safe spaces, entirely in the context of self, myself. I'm not talking about anybody else outside me right now. I'm talking about myself, right? So that's one quick functional definition of how where we are going to operate from. So that's just a simple sort of principle we'll follow in this entire exercise. And more broadly, talking about what inclusion means, I'm coming also from the point of view of mind. Where does the mind feel more included? And what are the different impacts that it can have in terms of you alone or on your team and your organization? And then in that specific context, I'm not going to try and define inclusion, because inclusion itself means that any different diversity is a part of one when you're working together, and still you figure out a way to move forward. That's a simple idea of definition or inclusion for me. So which exact inclusion? Is it social? Is it mental? Is it sexual orientation inclusion? Is it mental health inclusion? I don't think there are any that many different types of inclusion at all. When it comes to me, me as an individual feeling included, feeling respected, my emotions are acknowledged and in most places respected, and I'm able to express those emotions and I'm able to thrive. That's a simple functional definition of what inclusion at an individual level means for me. Do we all agree with this? Yeah? Yes. Any different views, anything that is missed out of this? And of course, this is not even sort of, we don't even need to mention it again, but this is irrespective of which gender, which class, which section of the society. None of these norms matter. Irrespective of where you are, what your starting point is, you are free to express yourself, your emotions are respected, and you are able to grow. These are the three simple sort of principles of inclusion for me when it comes to inclusion of self, right? Now, another thing I want to sort of start your sort of just get your quick views on. Are we hearing a lot about mental health these days?
Yeah.
Yes? Why are we hearing so much about mental health suddenly? And why are they talking about it?
It's a cause of concern.
It's a cause of concern, okay. Why do you think so?
This is a factor. They're seeing people who are talking about it realize that there's something different. There's something going on that they're not able to probably find answers to. It's affecting the way they perform. It's affecting the way they think. And I think that ambiguity is what is probably encouraging them to speak out about it, to look
sure.
at finding answers.
Sure.
Say that something's off. Something doesn't feel right. Or I don't have answers.
Okay.
People are probably being educated about it. Earlier it was brushed away. Mental health was considered like something that you cannot speak about. But I think now because there is a voice to it, people are talking about it.
And also compared to the our previous generation, this generation has a lot of platforms that their opinions can be voiced.
Sure.
But it's easy for the information to be put out.
Sure.
And also collectively feel about how the other person is feeling.
Sure.
मेंटल हेल्थ मेरे ख्याल से कहीं ना कहीं शायद सामने आ रहा है क्योंकि उससे फिजिकल हेल्थ भी इम्पैक्ट हो रहा है लाइक आई हैव लाइक हेडेक और लाइक एसिडिटी या हार्ट बर्न या समथिंग आई गो टू द डॉक्टर डॉक्टर दवाई देने से डेफिनेटली पूछता है कि आपकी ज़िंदगी कैसे चल रही है आपकी लाइफ स्टाइल क्या है क्या स्ट्रेस है सो आई थिंक दैट टू बी ऑल्सो वन ऑफ द रीजन
Absolutely, yes, absolutely. Anything else apart from this?
I think acknowledgement, and more and more people are acknowledging that they are having this particular problem. So they just want to share this problem, that so others who are going through the same phase, they can, you know, get some confidence to talk about this.
Absolutely. Yeah.
And I think बच्चों में ये ज़्यादा अभी और देखने को मिल रहा है जो पहले शायद ये उतना notice नहीं होता था कि छोटे बच्चों में भी बहुत types के stress या जो issues आ रहे हैं वो शायद पहले उतने notice नहीं होते थे कि
absolutely
तो इसीलिए वो क्यों हो रहा है और बच्चे खेल क्यों नहीं रहे या तो maybe the focus has shifted कि और क्या problems हो सकते हैं
एंड उस कॉम्पिटिशन को अचीव करने के लिए बहुत सारी चीज़ों को कॉम्प्रोमाइज कर रहे हैं लोग, सेक्रीफाइस कर रहे हैं एंड कंपैरिजन बहुत हाई लेवल पर स्टार्ट होने लगा है विद इन द सोसाइटी और विद इन द कम्युनिटी.
श्योर.
तो जिसकी वजह से बहुत सारे आउटकम्स निकल के आ रहे हैं. तो अभी देखा जाए सुसाइड रेट बहुत हाई हो गया है या एनजाइटी या लाइक गायत्री ने बोला कि प्रॉब्लम्स बहुत ज़्यादा आ रहा है निकल के आ रहा है.
Yeah, absolutely. There is building stress. There is one thing is just that the platforms are available now. Somebody said that there is vocabulary, right? I mean, there wasn't vocabulary in most of our languages. If you think of Indian languages even now, just try to think about words for depression, anxiety. They don't exist. So now at least a certain segment of society has the language to speak about mental health and talk about mental health issues, right? But even that is very disproportionate today, right? If you think about a person who does not speak English and has no access to the resources, still a lot is tucked under the carpet without actually realizing the issue that a person is facing are essentially mental health issues, right? You know, I was actually reminded of when I talk about mental health, and there are many like me who have started talking a lot about this. Each one has a different starting point in this. One very important factor for me to start talking about this and also in the context of organizations, making it inclusive, A, is that I was reminded of how gender started getting included in sociology and general social discourse, right? I clearly, in fact, distinctly remember my own class of sociology in Tata Institute of Social Sciences. We studied entire sociology, and towards the end, there was one session on gender, right? So it was an annex. So sometimes it's an annex, sometimes it's an afterthought, sometimes it's a postscript. But what is gender is basically that cuts across everything else you talk about, because that is as fundamental as it can be to a human being, right? A person. It's a core part of your identity. Similarly, with mental health, what's happening is, after everything else, let's talk about mental health now, because it is so important. It is a crisis that we have reached. There is so much anxiety, there is so much stress. General, talking about thoughts and feelings comes as an afterthought, comes afterwards. Let's do everything important first, and let's talk about mind, let's talk about heart, let's talk about how we are feeling. A lot of this comes as an afterthought. In whichever way, it's a great thing that mental health is getting included in our day-to-day discussions now. We are able to talk within our organizations. We are able to talk to some of our colleagues, some of our friends, some of our family members about this. But still, there is a lot that needs to be done about this, right? Because it's actually, it's not that everything else that you do impacts your mental health. What you do actually is an outcome of how your mental health is. So just placing that importance to mental health, not just, oh, you're doing great, okay, are you taking also, like, taking care of your mental health? No, it's actually a part of your everything that you do. Every single action, every single thought is very closely linked to how your mind is doing. And as she was saying, sorry, I didn't get your
Gayatri.
As Gayatri was saying, one very fundamental factor is the physiological or physical impact of how your mental health is. And that is where somewhere everybody starts thinking that, okay, there is something wrong with me. There is headache, there is this unexplained back pain, there is this unexplained joint pain, there is this unexplained Monday blues, which happen on Thursdays sometimes. And then there are this essential, this thing, work from home day today, I don't feel like going out. All of this together, right? All of these are impacts or effects of something that is so internal to us, something that is so integral to us, but not being talked about adequately or not having enough platforms to talk about that. So the whole sort of discussion that we will do today is built around this. And inclusion and making workplaces more inclusive is inclusive in this sense that wherever we are today, how can we start feeling better in our organizations and what can organization do for you to feel better, which is a collective responsibility, which is not something that can happen by just the leader of the organization in whichever organization you are. It will have to happen at each of us, our levels. And then how can we do that, right? Shall we do this in this session? Yeah? Okay. Now, in terms of specific strategies, even before jumping into it, right, I want to show some core values that I feel are sort of a basis to all that we are going to talk about today. Let's see how many of us agree with some of these values. Some of these may not resonate with you. Let's talk about it. We'll just stop here. In case we are not able to read it, we are doing the best we can. All of us at any given point in time are doing the best we can. Do we all agree?
Yes.
Yeah? Majority of us agree?
Yes.
With a caveat, yes, please. Say it out.
I think all of us at any given point do the best we think we can.
Okay, and yes. Then what is the difference between this and that?
So this, I think, if I would talk about my own example, I would say that I am doing the best I can versus this I think I can. For example, right now if you ask myself, am I doing all I can? Probably the answer will be yes.
Okay.
Isn't pushes me,
pushes you to...
Okay, you're thinking, you're operating from this lens. You think that means self-perception that this is the best you are doing.
Okay.
But can you push beyond that? Just
okay.
Start thinking.
We'll come to it. Anything else? Anything? Anybody feels differently about this? Yeah.
I rarely feel that I do the best I can.
You do the best you can.
I rarely feel that.
You really feel it.
Yeah.
Fantastic.
Rarely
feel it. Oh, I heard really feel it, and I'm like, okay, that's fantastic. I'm congratulating you. You rarely feel you are doing the best that you can. Okay. Can we go to the next one? We are going to come to that, both of these points. We all want to improve. The common characteristic of all of us is that we want to improve our lives and be happy.
Yes.
Yeah? Do we all agree with this?
Yes.
Okay, fantastic. We need to do better, try harder, and be more motivated to change. So we are doing the best we can, and we do want to even do better. But that itself is not adequate to solve a whole bunch of problems.
Yeah.
Sometimes,
yeah?
Yes.
Kind of. Yeah. Why is that?
I mean, in some situations, in some things, I feel like, yeah, we're doing the best that we could have done. But there are some things which we can change and do better. So it depends. It's very situational, this one.
Okay. Do we need to remain more motivated to change?
Yeah, we need to always constantly be motivated, but not in every sphere is what I feel. Like some things... We're doing the best.
Let it be, like chill.
Yeah.
No?
Yeah, sometimes you need to.
Relax, it's okay,
yeah.
You can be what you are. Okay, we'll actually understand how each of these value we should take. Any different views on this? People at the back, are your minds here? Yes? Are we doing your man ki baat?
I would like to add one word. We are doing the best possible we can. So the difference is versus idealism versus pragmatism.
What does that mean?
So best possible would simply mean that the possibilities are defined by our inherent capabilities.
Okay.
Not necessarily something ideal.
Right. Okay. Next one. We may not have caused all of our problems, but we have to solve them anyway. Do we agree with this? Yeah? Say more. We heard a lot of this in the previous session, no? That the fantastic speakers that we had, one thing that was coming to my mind is consistently this one value is that there is just so much that is sometimes just out there, which is not what in the millennial term, not my mess, but you still have to clean it. No? Yeah.
Not everything is in our control, right? Like some things are out of our control and we cannot solve them.
Okay. So let's read the tag, sort of more description of the value is that we have to change our behavioral responses and alter our environment to change our lives.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah? Is it running all over the place? No? Clear? As a value? Yeah? Okay. All behaviors, actions, thoughts, and emotions are caused. There is always a cause or set of causes for our actions, thoughts, and emotions, even if we do not know what the causes are. Yeah? One sort of service plus at the same time disservice mental health awareness has done is it has given so many terminologies to people that one common terminology is trigger. He triggered me, she triggered me, that triggered me, my Ola driver triggered me. You know, the triggers are almost always there. We are using a lot of them sometimes even without sort of being exactly aware of the terminologies. But if there is one right terminology or right place where we were to use this, that the it's just simply saying that trigger is outside, trigger is also inside. So a lot of time your own trigger is setting off. And why is it? Because it's mostly our own actions, feelings and thoughts which are kind of driving a certain behavior out of you. Okay? And new behavior has to be practiced in all relevant contexts. This is another value, which is basically one common thing that I sort of, when we are talking also about inclusion, right? I'm very sure you have done workshops similar to this before. Have you? Some or the other kind of inclusion, on gender inclusion in at workplaces. It could be in some other form, in classrooms about learning, different learning abilities. More making classrooms more inclusive. We have talked about this, all of this, right? You know, one of the fundamental challenges about what sort of stops from one question that Gayatri brought at the beginning was, we know a lot of this, how do we practice it? That's where wo raste mein kho jate hai, right? One of the main reasons for like getting lost on the path to sort of doing better, building more inclusive places, etc., is actually we wait for ideal situation to arise for us to behave ideally. मैं तो करने ही वाला था, मैं तो आज बुद्धा जैसे ही react करने वाला था, लेकिन फिर उसने ऐसे बोला तो फिर मुझे बोलना ही पड़ा, क्यों ऐसे छोड़ देता मैं, right? Or sometimes something happened, you know, I was going to really, really focus on this project, but something else happened, so it just couldn't, I just could not get back to sort of that level of concentration, number of different things, right? Just that the behavior that we learn, the new skills that we learn, quite often remain in that particular situation and we forget that they need to be practiced in all possible situations, in all possible circumstances. It is not that when you behave mindfully or you act in a certain way, it's not an afterthought, it's not for waiting for the ideal condition. We actually act on that learned behavior practically in every situation of our lives. And we do not isolate any single instance or wait for an ideal condition. So, are we okay to go ahead with these values also for this session? Do we all believe in this? Yeah? Just to sort of, wherever there were a couple of points, couple of different sort of views on this, we are doing the best we can, is as simple as what we read it, right? A lot of times, when we talk about all this anxiety, stress building, one of the fundamental, and we talked about a lot about this in the previous session, both speakers were very, very graceful enough to talk about their insecurities, talk about the fears that they felt. One of the major fundamental sort of barriers to actually start sort of building spaces which are more inclusive, which are more healthy, is that this fundamental belief that I actually had an option of choosing two different behaviors and I chose one, which seemed like a choice, a rational choice that I made. Honestly speaking, if you just think about it, and we will go into how mind functions, there is actually no such thing called choice of behavior. When you do certain thing, that indeed is the only option that you had. Just think a little bit about it. That we always impose so many different sort of expectations and rules onto ourselves that we actually had an option of doing things differently. There isn't. What we act is actually, most of us are already have a rational mind. Wherever it is not, we even there is immense capacity to act according to what your mind says. And what your mind says is already a very complex process. It's not just a spontaneous, mindless action. It's actually the only option, the only action available to us. That's like a fundamental sort of value, that we need to operate out of as one sort of quick reminder to keep ourselves every day. We want to improve. I think it's much easier to understand, right? I think there was more agreement in the room about we want to improve. Everybody wants to improve. Just talk to people. There will be 1 million things people tell that they want to improve about themselves. And a lot of them are actually in very, very good direction, in very good intention. I still haven't come across a person who has been sitting there and thinking about how do I harm myself or others intentionally. The intention at least is always that I want to do better. Don't know the way, like I'm getting lost in the route somewhere. We need to do better, try harder, and be more motivated to change. This is at the basis of any work, any commitment that you make, right? And particularly when we talk about making spaces more inclusive, this is actually almost at the basis of this, that yes, we could be doing a lot of things great already. We already know that we want to go improve ourselves, but that effort needs to be continuous and that commitment needs to remain almost on a daily basis, because if it is not there, then the progress gets stuck somewhere. And that is where the challenge starts coming in, when we go and sit in this perfect person syndrome, where I am already in a place where I don't need to improve any further, or I have already reached a place where I don't think there is anything that can actually disturb me. That's one trap. And the value then hence is that there is always scope for me to keep doing better. This is fairly easy to understand. There is a lot of sort of like this pep talk that goes out. A lot of these motivational sort of talks that we hear use this a lot. We may not have caused our problems, but soch badlo, aapki zindagi badlegi, aapki reality badlegi. We have heard that a lot, no? In advertisements, we have heard, I've heard some Akshay Kumar saying somewhere, ki soch ko badlo, zindagi badlegi. All of this, no? Yes?
Just a thought, you said it is difficult to find a person who can harm himself or herself or others intentionally.
Mm-hmm.
So what about smoker or they are actually harming themselves intentionally?
Yes.
So, I mean, this is just a thought. I mean, in what category that person is
falling? There are two possible sort of, one is why do they switch to addictions itself? It's a conscious choice that a person is making, that same different sort of, there are many ways to satisfy your mind. It's calling for something for sure. Hence you switch to addiction of any kind, right? Smoking, or it could be practically any other addiction. That's a very simple one line answer to that. And B, just because people are committed to doing better does not mean that they're actually doing better in every aspect of their lives. I could be standing here giving a talk on, let's say, mindfulness and being nice to each other, etc. All the different things, I might even mean it. I go outside, the driver doesn't show up for 10 minutes, and the first thing is, kahan chale gaye the aap? Right? I mean, the tone changes suddenly. And then that suddenly sort of, so does not mean that it always translates into good action or right action all the time. But the intention is there. Intention is there. People often tend to bring extreme examples of personality disorders or people with specific disorder, mental disorders, who seem to be doing harmful actions. Even in that, the intention is actually, you would be surprised how many cases seem like this person just has quote unquote lost his or her mind, is doing so many crimes. Even in that, the intention to do good is unbelievable. And I'm actually taking a couple of very extreme examples here, but also that just applies to practically even basic instances in our lives. If you have seen in 70s and 80s, there were a lot of people who had cannibalistic tendencies were interviewed after them having sort of eaten some 17, 18 people. I'm taking a very extreme example for a reason. You should see their interviews which are there afterwards. A psychologist has talked to them for about an hour. A person who, what we consider as the most cruel person who has eaten other people, actually for 1 hour is talking about how he or she wanted to do better in life. Right? So that innate sort of need to be better, do better, is always there. The challenge is that the path sometimes is not there. External circumstances are sometimes not there. The emotional validation that your atmosphere, your ecosystem needs to give is not there. And the third itself is retaining that consistent, any motivation works on A is how much you feel it from inside, and B is how much it is acknowledged outside. The reinforcement part of psychology, right? The reinforcement part of human mind. So in these three basically explain why a person behaves in a certain way. But in terms of just commitment to do better, that is in our cognition. As a human race or as a living being, that need to do better just exists there. We will not see a status quo mind at all. And then all behaviors, actions, thoughts, and emotions are caused. We'll actually come to this. We'll actually learn a very nice structure for understanding this. And new behavior has to be practiced in all relevant contexts, right? So this is something which is as a value again. Just understand that when we switch the focus, and I again heard a lot of this from both the speakers, particularly when the lady was, Ashwita was talking about, is that certain part of your mind gets affected in a certain way. You're growing up in a certain way. You're growing up in emotionally and socially invalidating atmosphere. And naturally, it affects you. We heard the entire journey of how it affects particularly the self-esteem part, self-identity, and self-confidence part, right? Now, what you actually do, and what resilience is another word that speakers in both the speakers used in their previous in the session, is that you actually adopt healthy behavior practices, and then you continue with those practically in every circumstance, every situation of your life. So you are essentially breaking the chain of things that bring you down, that make you feel bad about yourself, and you adopt a behavior, then that becomes something that percolates, that sort of extends into all aspects of your life. That's something that we, what we mean by new behavior. When we decide to change ourselves, part of answer to Gayatri's question, that where do we get lost, is that we sort of keep asking ourselves, in this situation, do I react differently, or I sort of go back to my old patterns? No, the answer is once you commit to sort of doing better thinking, adopting more cognitively sort of resilient methods of thinking and behaving, then you continue them across all different parts of your life. You don't restrict them to only in office, at not at home, etc. Okay, good to go from here. Yeah, a quick mood check. How are we feeling? Lost? Present? Anything else? A quick mood check is what I'll keep doing once in a while. Happy? Yes. He was just smiling, so I was like, wrong person to ask?
He's always
happy. Oh, okay, that's fantastic. Who else wants to be always happy, by the way? In the room? Okay, always happy. Everybody wants to be always happy. Okay? So, who said this? Yes, high five to you. Yes, so much pressure to be always happy, no? Okay, how else, this part, how are you feeling? Talk about yourself, yes.
It's interesting.
It's interesting, okay?
Curious about what comes next.
Okay. This part?
Connected.
Okay, you are able to connect? Okay, fantastic. How are you feeling?
I'm feeling
interested. Because it is interesting. Okay. How are you feeling, ma'am?
I'm feeling curious to know, like, what is next.
What is next? Okay. All this build up towards what? Okay.
It's going good, dear.
You know, tell me one thing honestly. Are you convinced about that answer? Then I'm going to take it at face value. Okay, so what is the other part that is not true?
Kind of skeptical if all of this would be like implementable in like...
Fantastic. Okay, I love to hear that. Okay?
I'm curious too.
Okay? And this side, yes?
Processing.
Okay. What are you processing?
Everything. Just going answers.
Right. Okay. You know, that's the problem with these sessions on mind, etc., right? They just sort of like, there's just so much that comes in. Plus, also after 3 days of intense taking in and now also making sense of all of this. Okay. We'll see. So, first, yes, Gayatri.
I think it's really interesting. what is going on. मुझे पता है यहाँ पे इंग्लिश सब लोग फॉलो कर रहे हैं,
हाँ.
कुछ लोग हैं जो शायद एकदम फॉलो नहीं कर पा रहे हैं.
अच्छा
बीच बीच में थोड़ा सा जो बातचीत
है. यस और मैं बोलूंगा तो आप एक बार फिर से रिमाइंड कीजिए.
हाँ मतलब इवन आज आल्सो
हाँ जी बिल्कुल आंसर्स भी दें.
और नॉन हिंदी भी है
हाँ.
बट वो लैंग्वेज मुझे नहीं पता तो मुझे कैसे.
हाँ इसीलिए मैंने वो टॉपिक भी बंद कर दिया. मैंने कहा इंग्लिश हिंदी ठीक है. We'll definitely switch at least between English and Hindi, and wherever if there is somebody else able to speak in that language, please feel free.
Yeah, I think we should do this very quite often, like in every 10 minutes that time.
The
mood check. Yeah,
mood check. Mood check. I love this. Yes, I will do that consistently. And you are free to just tell that this is not like, you know, ye bahut upar se ja raha hai, interesting nahi lag raha hai, appeal nahi kar raha hai. Please just stop right there. No regrets after this session. Whatever is there, just badas nikal do. Wahin pe bol do. Right? Okay, next one. We'll simple things. How do we think? We have read this, we have seen this in 1 million places. But again, just for the sake of reinforcement, all that we saw the values before. And when I said that when we work on ourselves, or when we behave in a certain way, or when we are doing things in a certain way, that's the best option we have. This is how simply how our mind sort of works, right? Just think about any situation, practically in this moment, me talking. There is one response that is happening without you even realizing, which is called automatic response. You have seen a tall speaker before, that tall speaker was really boring. You are making a correlation, you are thinking that, you know, this will also be boring. There might have happened one team building session when you were in college. You realize that how that session was just useless. That person was going around speaking anything. That skepticism comes in. Then you have been in some session where you met another cute person who was also attending the session. Then sweet memories come into your head that, okay, you know. So that first response is absolutely not controlled. You cannot control it. A lot of us try to sort of like, you know, then there is this reminder. Then your thoughts get active. First is your mind reacting. First is your intuition reacting. First is your heart reacting. And that is the first reaction, which is just not in our control at all. Any situation that happens, right? We'll also learn how does that happen. But in the first, just understand that there is a first reaction that you cannot avoid. Anything that comes to your mind quickly, first reaction. Or we are clear in terms of that your mind or emotional reaction is the first one, right? Think of any crisis situation. First is, I'm scared. That what you feel is the first sort of response. No control, which is automatic. Automatic thoughts, images, there will be sort of your mind almost works like a giant computer. Sometimes the responses are from the immediate past. Sometimes the images that you remember are from the immediate past, like literally in the last 2-3 hours. Sometimes it could be from childhood. I'm sorry, but then mind is that it's also a bit of a troublemaker. You don't have a choice on what you choose as the first reaction. It can bring from a vast memory of your mind. It can literally pick anything to bring as a first reminder to you, right? Then comes sort of thought. Of appropriateness, not appropriateness. What I have been socially told I can do, not do. What am I allowed to think? What am I not allowed to think? I am sitting here thinking of something else. Oh, but our organization rule is we are committed to learning right now. So I have to stay committed to learning. Then I have made a note somewhere myself that from today onwards, I'll be very mindful in everything that I do. So that's another reminder that comes in. Right, so your first reaction is then just completely sort of muddled up with what all that you have trained yourself as appropriate behavior in such circumstances, in different situations. So you're thinking of all of that. And then comes a reaction, which again is happening at least 3 different levels. So don't take any of this as just one, this thing. It's one structure that I'm using to explain how it happens. There is one emotional reaction, which we talked about broadly, how it makes you feel. You hear that your colleague has got much bigger promotion than you have, or she has got much better traction with some partners than you have, right? One obvious this thing is to feel happy for her in a place where that kind of culture exists. Another very possible reaction is, why not me? Or why did I not get that traction? Both of these are natural emotions, but one is a simple emotional response where you have not thought about, oh, Tarun, fantastic, I'm so happy for you, is an afterthought, right? The first reaction could be very different. Sometimes it could be just the same. Doesn't matter. One is at just purely at the emotional level. Then second is at the behavioral level, which is what you actually speak out, what you actually act, what you actually do based on how you have felt, right? We can go and talk a lot about this in terms of purely just how we suppress our emotions in a lot of places and make way for behavior which is more acceptable rather than sort of what you actually feel like doing in those moments. Any quick sort of examples that come to your mind about this? बोलो एक तो बोलो
मेरा हस्बैंड अगर मुझे बोलता है कि ये क्यों नहीं हुआ बोले तुम ही कर देते मुझे क्यों
ओके
सो दैट वुड बी विद एंगर आल्सो विद
श्योर
सो इमीडिएट रिएक्शन इज व्हाई आई एम चार्ज व्हाई
श्योर ओके ओके एनीथिंग एल्स
नो फ्रेंड्स आई थिंक सप्रेस्ड एंगर कम्स हियर Socially, it's not acceptable to show anger.
Yeah.
So behaviorally, like people can suppress it, but emotionally, what is coming up is probably anger.
Absolutely. You know, that's a very fantastic point Himanshi has made. And in fact, in this entire understanding, this entire structure, understand that we have control only over this. We do not have control over this. We do not have control over this, actually. Some of these reactions are based on biological disposition that we have to any stimuli, external stimuli. We have heard something like, oh, she's too sensitive, or I'm too sensitive. Have you heard about this?
Yeah.
Or you should try and learn to be less sensitive, or you have to be a little less touchy in terms of just how you feel, right? I mean, you know, you should be a little less feels, too many feels, right? Isn't that another thing that we hear, right? The problem, or the sort of like one fundamental sort of mistake here we all make in understanding, is that you actually do not have any control over how emotional can you be. A large part of it is your biological disposition, which makes you super sensitive, less sensitive. So this is something that will just remain. This is a core part of us. So when we ask a person to change, become less sensitive, try to ask this question to yourself, that what do you actually mean then, right? So, but this we do not actually have much control over. This is something that we almost take it for granted. When it goes into the zone of dysregulation, regulation, yes, of course, there are strategies, ways of dealing with it, coping with it. But emotional responses, we do not control. Behavioral, we come to that. Physiological again, Gayatri, I think, was at the start mentioning that body ek hota hai, sardad hona shuru ho jata hai, joints ek hota hai. You wouldn't believe how many of actually conditions that we generally go to a general physician for actually have a root in how we are feeling on that day or for a prolonged period of time. It's actually if we were to look at the origin of a lot of our illnesses, you would be surprised that the origin will be perhaps in your mind. One of the major problems is that, let's say, for example, an emotion like anger, something that we all at this level feel. Do we not feel it here? Anybody in the room who feels no anger? No? Nobody? Okay. What about happy person? Where is he? Happy person disappeared. Happy person? Happy person, do you feel angry sometimes?
Yes.
Right? Okay. You know, we have to really, really, and by the way, not referring to him alone. I think Tarun and I were talking about this, right? We have to really burst this bubble of happiness. Happiness is not a permanent state. We don't reach there and then live there for happily ever after, right? All this that we feel, emotions, being one with them, respecting them, letting them sort of ourselves to feel them, yet keep marching towards what we are doing is happiness. Because, and Tarun actually gave a very nice example which resonated with me and that's staying with me even now, is that you are applying for, let's say, a grad school going forward. Or if you are writing for a, say for example, some government project comes up, as always, government asks you to give complete presentation plus budget in one day. So then you are all sort of, you get committed to it, you start working towards it. You feel everything. You feel stress, you feel anxiety, you feel pressure, you feel sad. You feel sometimes that my friends are right now hanging out in SDA, so I'd rather be there. So you also sacrifice. And then ultimately you complete and you submit and the government project comes through. That is when you actually perhaps feel happiness for 5 minutes. And then again the cycle starts where you are again going through this entire chain of events, entire chain of emotions. Each one of these emotions is actually contributing to your idea of happiness. So there is nothing that is called permanent happiness. So when we hear a lot about how to be happy, tell them actually it's okay, I am already happy. What I am feeling, acknowledging every emotion is happiness. Not actually seeking one emotion that is happiness, there isn't anything like that. Even if you think of just like how cognitively we are wired, how our brain is, there is no space for something called happiness. There's only some chemicals moving up and down, which can happen with respecting all your emotions and understanding happiness like that. Now, physiological we talked about. We also know a lot of different things, right? We use a lot of gestures. All of those are physiological reactions, but also not expressing emotions can emancipate physiologically. And behavior. Now, this is where we are all playing today in terms of this is not controllable, this is not controllable. Then how do we make workplaces inclusive? So how do we manage behavior? Is that a question? Because we are just saying that emotions are anyway what they are. Physiological symptoms of that will also remain what they are. Then we are still talking about changing our behavior. Do we think it's possible? Yes? Yes. How is it? Possible?
वहाँ लोगों को देख के हमें अपना एंगर नहीं स्टॉप करना पड़ता है तो हमारा सोशियोलॉजिकली जब हम जाते हैं तब हमें चेंज करते हैं
बिल्कुल सही हर एक सर्कमस्टेंस में हम अपना बिहेवियर चेंज करते हैं नाउ व्हेन हाँ हाँ जी
हम अपने घर में किसी पे भी चिल्लाते हैं लेकिन वही अगर हमारे ऑफिस में या हमारे से कोई ऊंची पोस्ट वाला बोले तो हम एक बार भी रिएक्ट नहीं करते
बिल्कुल सही है बिल्कुल सही
तो ये नहीं है कि गुस्सा आने के बाद हम इसे कंट्रोल नहीं कर सकते हम इंसान को देख के कंट्रोल करते हैं कि ये हमारा सुनेगा या नहीं
वेरी ट्रू
नहीं और हमारी नौकरी जाएगी या नहीं जाएगी
हाँ मूवी बिल्कुल है और ये भी देखा होगा घर में पापा के सामने और मम्मी के सामने अलग अलग बातें बोलते हैं एक ही इमोशन के बारे में है ना घर से बाहर जाने की परमिशन चाहिए मम्मी से बोलते वक्त
अलग तरीके सच बताते पापा के सामने आधी झूठ होती
है अच्छा और बताने का लहजा तरीका बदलता है बदलता है
मम्मी को तो बोलते हैं जाना है और पापा से पूछते हैं कि जाएं कि ना
अच्छा बिल्कुल यस एब्सोल्युटली लेकिन इमोशन तो एक ही होती है कि जाना है ना लेकिन उसको अलग अलग तरीके से हम एक्सप्रेस करते हैं इमैंसिपेट करते हैं व्हेन वी आर टॉकिंग अबाउट हम जब इंक्लूसिव वर्कप्लेसेस की बात करते हैं उसमें ये एक जरूरी है सबने याद रखना वन वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट थिंग टू रिमेंबर इज दैट ईच वन ऑफ अस वी आर ब्रिंगिंग सो मेनी इमोशंस एट वन वर्कप्लेस एंड इफ दैट्स वन स्ट्रगल शी जस्ट टॉक्ड अबाउट जस्ट थिंक अबाउट इट इट प्रैक्टिकली हैपन्स इन एवरी सिंगल मोमेंट योर emotion is something else, your reaction to that in your mind is something else, and you are consistently finding a right behavior. Okay, you know, some of these things become what we call our second nature, so we do not have to think so much about it. But in a lot of places, actually, we have to consistently juggle between what I'm feeling but what I'm actually going to behave, right? And when we make places inclusive, if you ask me if there is one single strategy to do sort of go towards more inclusive, particularly in terms of how you feel. The first and foremost for me would be to acknowledge that every person has similar emotions as you have. Nobody, and particularly, wo to boss hai, wo aisa kaise keh sakte hai? Yaar, boss ko bhi emotions honge hi, managers ko. And when we talked a lot about mentorship in the previous one of the major this thing is what is the level of responsibility you put on your mentor? The thing is, your mentor is not immune to any of this. Even a psychologist, a psychotherapist is not. A psychotherapist also is immune to emotions only as much as doctor is immune to common cold and cough. Right? You might have better tools to deal with it, but at the same time, you are not immune to it. So one is a simple acknowledgement that all of us will operate from our emotions. All of us, all of these emotions will be at play. And still we have to navigate through this. Still we have to sort of choose the right behaviors. We have to still choose the appropriate behaviors. That's the dilemma that we are kind of facing every day. Yeah? Friend, mood check? Sleepy? You're thinking a lot, actually, not required for this session. What are you thinking about so much? Do you want to share with some of us? I guarantee you that that much thought I have not put even in this session itself. Bataiye. Samajhte hain unhi se? Bataiye.
Whatever the slide, I mean, मैं यही सोच रहा था कि जो ऑटोमेटिक थॉट्स है मतलब आई एम अ फिजिसिस्ट सो मैं यही सोच रहा था यूरेका मूवमेंट्स भी ऑटोमेटिक होते नहीं होते सो दैट्स व्हाट आई वाज थिंकिंग
व्हाट इज योर कंक्लूजन सो फार
नहीं इससे रिलेटेड नहीं है
अच्छा इससे रिलेटेड नहीं है अच्छा तो
दैट्स अ डिफरेंट
बताइए अच्छा डीप थिंकिंग Do you think we can't deal with that death? Possibly? Okay. One simple suggestion, my friend. Do not overthink, right? We'll take it at face value. What is there. And we'll try and sort of... And all of your thoughts are valid. So bring anything. Even if it's too deep, we'll see. Yeah? Okay. All right. So one simple sort of... Every day demystifying people's behavior. How could she behave like that? How could he behave like that? One simple thing is just remember this cycle that every time there is certain situation, certain circumstances, there is going to be action, there is going to be first emotion related to that, attached to that. There will be an act, activity, behavior which the person has chosen out of. I might have felt 7 different feelings in my head. I will pick one out of that to actually behave in that particular situation. So second is giving enough credit for a person's behavior, taking it seriously to an extent that understanding that there is a reason. And then the last one, of course, is that what we see, what that behavior is actually just the best option that we have in that given situation. So a lot of times when we ask a person a question, how could you do this? I think that question itself is fallacious. I did this because that was the best option I had in front of me, is a simple answer one can give to ourselves. And it does actually, you know, lead to a path of actually a little bit more of liberation, because then you're not taking too much burden of thinking of why did that person behave like that. You're actually already answering that, okay, now let's assume that that person had that as the only option to do certain things, right? So this is a simple sort of explanation of how we operate, how we think, how emotions relate, go to thoughts, thoughts go to behavior, and it's a consistent cycle. It does not stop. In every single moment, it is going on again and again and again. Every time you try to stop it, it will just lead to another spiral. So that's the beauty of this, right? Okay. Actually, let's just go back for a second. Now with all of this, right? Yes, Himakshi?
So she saw all or nothing thinking.
And? What came to your mind?
Some automatic thoughts.
Okay, all right. Yes, sir. Please tell me.
If everyone thinks this is the best I do, then everything is justified, no?
Okay, very interesting one. Okay.
Terrorism is justified and anger is everything is justified.
Okay, all right. That's a very valid point, by the way. I'm going to talk about it. Did you also raise your hand? For the very good. Okay, so she is feeling cold. The mood there is cold. Let's tackle this first.
But I have a question.
Yes.
So if you're saying we do not have control over the emotional and the psychological and only behavioral, then when we are learning, like for example, we are learning today, we are learning maybe we should not do good, we should not do wrong, we should do good, then how are we...
What is it?
Freudian slip.
Freudian slip, okay. You explain, I don't know.
So then how are we mending our behavior if we are not able to have the control over these emotions?
Okay. Yes? Just say it.
I was wondering when we get to the next slide.
We'll get, when will we get? When, like, okay, you, by that logic, I think you have more interest in what's happening after the session. I just kept hearing after. Okay, we'll come to that. All right, one quick, yes.
So, mera ek quick thought.
Haan ji, haan ji.
I think wo behavior mein to nahi nikal jata hai. To kabhi kabhi aisi bhi situation aati hai ki jab zid dominate kar raha hota hai.
Right, yes, impulses, yes.
And aapko pata hota hai ki uska outcome kya nikalne wala hai.
Correct.
But फिर भी वो डोमिनेट कर रहा होता है तो उस कंडीशन में हाउ वी कैन मैनेज द बिहेवियर
ग्रेट ऑलराइट सो वन इज दैट हाउ डू वी जस्टिफाई बिहेवियर्स यस हाउ डू वी जस्टिफाई अ लॉट ऑफ नॉट करेक्ट बिहेवियर्स सेकंड इज जस्ट हाउ डू वी सॉर्ट ऑफ लाइक या
मैनेजेबल
नो नो इफ यू स्टार्ट कीप आस्किंग द क्वेश्चन तो आई थिंक
नहीं जस्ट बी ऑब्जेक्टिव अबाउट इट
Neha, do you want to come? Come join us. Yes, come here. And
no, I think Salim to कह रहे कि मुझे भी मैं भी उस सिचुएशन में काफी हुआ मेरे साथ
सर सलीम जानते हैं
सलीम कौन है
मैं पिछले सेशन में भी सलीम सलीम सुन रहा था सलीम बोल रहा है दोनों सलीम है ओके
इंडियन मतलब हम जनरली क्या कहते हैं हम ऑब्जर्व भी जो करते हैं तो हम कम्युनिटी में या सोसाइटी में जो भी हम देखते हैं कि ज़्यादातर जो आउटकम्स मतलब वर्स्ट इसलिए हो जाती है क्योंकि उसमें कहीं ना कहीं ईगो या जिद डोमिनेट होता है हावी होता है
बिल्कुल बिल्कुल
उसको कैसे मैनेज कराया जाए अगर वो साइंस ऑफ चेंज हमें पता लगता है देन मेरे ख्याल से वो नॉलेज
हम इसके बारे में बात करेंगे एंड यू आर सेइंग सम
I was saying if we are not able to have control over these emotions that you just said, how can we bring about a change in the behavior?
Sure. I'll start with Chris.
Yes.
Yes. What Chris said. Yes, we do not have control over what is our mind's first sort of like emotional reaction. Does not mean that we can condition our mind. And over a period of time, take control of our emotions or have emotions which are sort of, there is just in no situation we can still control how our emotions are, Chris. But at the same time, we can actually sort of at least go towards a place where we have better hold or better understanding of our emotions. That's the best we can reach. In terms of just controlling your emotions, that's unfortunately a myth that is sort of so much like there is this entire literature that goes around which basically considers one sort of like neuro sort of one type of brain functioning and imposes things like make a list and go through that list and you will succeed, for example. That's one. Second is follow time and you will sort of reach wherever you want to reach. There's another this thing that you can actually control your emotions. You cannot. Your reaction cannot. It's only the behavior part you're able to control and linked emotions to it, you can only understand them better and manage them better. That's really the difference, right? Okay, I'm going to go into certain sort of like, this is like some simple cognitive errors that all of us all make, all that we have talked about so far in terms of just emotions and how does it actually sort of translate into what are the different traps that we cognitive traps that we often fall into. Without even realizing. So when we react, all of us tend to follow certain patterns. And the assumption is that when we are able to at least identify these cognitive patterns, we are able to control some of this better and control how we react to things slightly differently. Yes? One is all or nothing thinking. Have you heard about this black and white thinking?
Yeah.
Which is?
It's either yes or no. There's no in between.
Okay, yes, anything else? Like any specific example? Yes.
No, I just made a fun of
it. So, say that fun.
Huh?
that actually sounded like a very good example. Please tell me. Oh, अच्छा, okay. किसी specific person की बात कर रहे हैं या दुनिया में?
It's just random images came in.
Okay.
First thought.
First thought. Okay. And he verbalized it. Right. You know, so many different things. Yeah. There is one person. Sometimes that person is actually सबसे खराब इंसान है या सबसे बढ़िया है. Something in between. Just giving that entire sort of space for benefit of doubt in a way. That's one thing we do not tend to do. Without realizing, we tend to take this extreme or that extreme. Sometimes even just out of this obsessive need to be sure of everything. We do not need to be. We are very, very scared of ambiguity in general as mind, and that reacts to basically one basic simple cognitive trap we all tend to do is think about things in extremes. Those extremes will be mostly negative or positive. Completely negative, completely positive. There is nothing in between, right? So this is one simple cognitive error for us to sort of start repairing by just acknowledging sometimes that I encourage people to do it on the person you hate the most. It could be the landlord who does not allow you to come in late or sort of calls your parents to, it could be practically anybody. Just pick the person you dislike the most and start giving them a benefit of doubt, or at least see that there cannot be, I'm yet to come across a person who's absolutely an evil person. Or I'm yet to come across a person who's just 100% flawless. All of us are actually in between somewhere. All of us. So acknowledging that simple fact that every behavior, every action is somewhere in between. It is neither all incorrect or neither all correct. And there is always a scope for improvement. That is one simple thing. Just start giving this benefit of doubt to people or to yourself in the first place. Right? I am absolutely good at something. I am horrible at something. There is nothing in between that I am actually learning to do certain things better. You know, that sort of building that... Nothing? Okay. Building that... Yes?
So, how does values operate? Let's say, like, I really care about something like punctuality. I do think I have a all or nothing thinking about a particular
mm-hmm.
value.
Mm-hmm.
So, I actually find it very hard to see great. I mean, I'm able to feel the emotion when
sure.
somebody is not punctual.
Sure.
I'm able to give benefit of doubt, but every time things are not punctual
mm-hmm.
around me, it definitely continues to be the same emotional pattern.
Sure.
I've changed my behavior not
to
react as much.
But I have just to add to what Tarun said, does that emotion or does that feeling relate to the person, or is it just the value in itself? Just to add to that, like, sometimes even I feel for some particular values, there are black and white. But
yes.
does that translate to also, it could translate to also the person, but again you can make...
See, there is absolutely, first of all, like there will be certain core beliefs which form the core identity of yourself or which you have acquired over a period of time to the point that it has become almost your second nature that for me punctuality matters. There is just no reason to think that you just cannot have a particular value which is absolutely sort of non-negotiable for yourself. It depends on now, when you do not see it into others, how are you able to see it? How are you able to talk about it? And how are you able to reach the point where you are able to both appreciate that there is certain functional definition of punctuality between you and the other person? That is where the trick lies. There is absolutely nothing wrong with you having your values in place. But at the same time, you also sort of acknowledging that other person may or may not subscribe to those values or behave according to that in every single situation. There might be different reaction to that in different places. And then being able to communicate to that and communicate through right behavior. That is where the trick really is. The next one is cognitive filtering. The image itself here is not that great. But cognitive filtering is something again that we use quite often, is that it's basically like taking a microscopic view of a particular situation, that you have a certain worldview, you have a certain view, yaar ispe kuch nahi badlega. That's one thing that we always hear. In development sector, you go to somebody, talk about your work to relatives, haan ye bahut kar chuke hai, aisa kuch nahi hota hai, kuch nahi badlega. You know that we hear a lot, right? One common reaction that we get a lot, which is our mind's reaction as well, quite often. That we already operate out of filters which we are not aware of. we filter out a lot of information which is actually sort of relevant, and we stick to only one which suits what we have been consistently thinking about over a period of time, right? I'm just moving a little faster. My friend is showing me the time placard, so I'm going to sort of keep flowing a little bit. If you have any specific points, just stop me if it's not clear. Can we go to the next one? Jumping to conclusions. One, again, very common thing that we do, think of any office communication. We are operating out of either of these two. We are either reading other person's mind and anticipating what that person must be thinking, or using past information to become fortune tellers, that somebody just comes to your, like a colleague comes to you and offers you a cup of tea. The first thing is, aaj hi kyun kar raha hai? Aaj tak to kabhi nahi kiya tha. That is one. Second is, kuch na kuch to chahiye hoga mujhse. So that is second. And third is, isne kuch na kuch to aage mere se achieve karna hai isliye, right? So basically, kuch isne nahi kiya hai isliye. If your parents, if your teachers, that's another one, right? No, I'm just saying, like, in general, like, who are the people who would generally face it, right? One is that we are always reading other person's mind. We are trying to anticipate. It's not wrong. It's good to be actually aware of other person's emotions. But there's taking it to another level. If you are trying to read other person's mind and responding based on what you thought that other person is thinking, rather than saying what you feel, or arriving sort of like at a more balanced conclusion. And the second one is fortune telling. You know that what's going to happen. This happens a lot with particularly us working with different governments. Ye sarkari officers aise hi hote hain. Half of our initiatives are built around this fortune telling. That, you know, like a lot of times they will react in a certain way. One part is to use your knowledge, which is absolutely useful. Other is actually getting trapped into this, that without having adequate data, information about a particular situation, us telling the future. That's the second sort of part of it. A simple cognitive error to overcome. We'll go to the next one. Yes, please.
A clarification. So jumping to conclusions, it's different from, you know, seeing, observing a pattern and making maybe inference or predicting what might happen.
All of us do that. There is no choice, you know, but at the same time, basing your entire behavior or reaction basis on what you thought, instead of asking the question to other person, for example, if there is a choice, that why did you behave in a certain way, you already assume that the person will behave in a certain way, or the person already has, you have certain assumptions about what the other person is saying. Or sometimes even about yourself, right? I cannot do this. I have never been good at writing proposals. A simple thing, I will not be able to do it. You are fortune telling and limiting sort of your own abilities as well by just telling a couple of simple things where sort of you're not giving enough chance to yourself and arriving at a conclusion, which is a simple cognitive barrier again.
Yeah, I have a question.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, while telling the conclusion, like, why don't you include the point of dictatorship?
Which is?
Dictatorship. You told that we assume when others are thinking. It's from the point of others. And for fortune telling, it's like assuming what we know the future. Then why don't you involve the point of dictatorship, like people assuming that whatever they know and whatever the knowledge they have, that is true and that will be true.
This is a message to dictator only.
No,
that when you dictate next time, remember that you don't know.
The point is that while in the conclusions, it might come to this type of experience. It might come with a time of exposure, right? So
yes.
So why don't you involve that point in that?
Clarify it for me again, sorry.
So my point is that while giving the conclusion, we might also, a person will also think like whatever I know that will be correct, because that will come with some sort of experience, right? And that point may not know to the point. So why don't you involve that point in the point of conclusion?
Where would you involve this, just from?
Like,
that's what mind reading is all about. You assume that, you know, what the others are.
So in mind reading, we are trained that we assume what others are thinking, right? So it comes from the point of others, what they are thinking. Like you gave the example, if you are giving me tea only today, then why are you giving only today? If that thinking is coming from others, right? So my point is that, why don't the thinking come from ourselves, like with our experience? in the point of conclusion.
You're saying if that person has done something like that before, and now I'm assuming because that person has done...
See, mind reading is... One second. Let's just take a step back here. Mind reading is simply that without actually asking the other person what your intentions are, you already anticipate that the person is doing this. You are trying to, in a way, explain other person's behavior by assuming what must be going on in her or his mind. It's as simple as that.
So my point is that extremely different from what you're telling in the point of mind reading.
Okay.
So my point is that we are looking only from the person what others are thinking. But why don't we look at the point of ourselves thinking?
Fair enough. So you're saying why don't you check your own values, beliefs and this thing, right? Don't you think this entire process itself is that? That you're asking yourself where are you coming from?
When we are seeing the context of what others are thinking, then what is the relation of our self-thinking?
Can you give an example?
No. So, you're asking in the right direction. Each one of these cognitive patterns, aren't they a part of the process itself that you're questioning your own thinking? You're asking where are you coming from?
Yeah, I think.
Isn't it? So, mind reading, like, how can your own mind read its own mind? Like, you know, that's the challenge that is there, that your own mind cannot give the perspective of outsider. But at the same time, this entire process is a part of actually asking where are you coming from, trying to read your mind. Clearer?
Yeah.
Okay, we'll go to the next one. Emotional reasoning. This is basically just sort of taking a lot of burden on emotional burden on yourself. You are responsible for something. You have done this. I am feeling frustrated. I am feeling angry. Why am I feeling angry? I should not be feeling angry. A whole lot of sort of burden on yourself that you are trying to explain every external situation in context of how you are feeling about it, and also finding a reason in yourself that how you have caused it. And that's a major challenge because you cannot actually control a lot of things that happen outside you, around you. Hence, you do not have any locus standi there sometimes. You do not actually have any reason sort of like to take it onto yourselves. But there is this one almost an obsessive sort of a pattern, or sometimes harmless but existent in us, that we do not know that we are trying to find emotional reasons or sort of reasoning in our own mind, that I am responsible for something, which you perhaps are not, right? Okay? Labeling and self-labeling. Labeling others and labeling yourself, right? Take any example from every day. I am silly, I am lazy, I am never in time, I am crazy like that. Now, thanks to this entire mental health awareness, all the labels, I am OCD, I am this and that. A whole bunch of labels that we keep attaching ourselves, right? There is one problem is we are being too early in giving that label, and the other one is when you attach a certain label to you, it starts becoming your reality. Think of any label to any object, leave aside human beings. A road for a long time has some official name, starts getting called, let's say, Champagali, and then becomes Champagali eventually, to the point that we forget what was the original name of the road. Does this happen to a lot of different places? The same thing happens with us, that when we keep labeling ourselves again and again and again in a certain way, we do not actually give ourselves to behave, chance to behave differently. We just not just take up that label, but we also fall in love with that label. And quite often, the label is self-restrictive. That is where the challenge is. So labeling, finding your identity, we also find our identity through different labels, right? We are something, we are somebody's sort of whatever, like child or somebody's daughter, somebody's son. All of these are also, in a way, somebody might say label. But this is a lot more of attaching emotional labels to yourself, describing your traits through certain labels, and also then almost living up to that through your behavior. That becomes another major barrier, right? And the second one is also putting labels to others. Actually, you know, the easiest thing to do is actually to give labels without realizing the real sort of what does it really mean, or actually taking the responsibility to change the behavior. So that is another basic cognitive error that a lot of us make. We'll go to the next one. Overgeneralizing. Slightly different from black and white, we take one emotional instance and generalize it in all different situations, all different circumstances. Just think again about, like, there are so many different things that happen around us where we take one, like a lot of situations, you have to actually say that, calm down. You know, when you're talking, somebody was like, we were talking about talking to your mother, like your father, for example, when we were talking about previous session. One thing that came to my mind is that something sometime has happened wrong to someone. We take that one as a clue to generalize it in all possible situations. That's a very simple sort of, sometimes we are not even aware of it, but we do it. Something has gone wrong once, and we'll just sort of live the rest of our life trying to prevent something that may not even happen again. That is simply overgeneralizing a simple, small fact, right? Take the next one. Disqualifying all the positive and looking at only negative. Again, something that happens almost on a daily basis, that something wrong happens that does not make us happy. We take that as one sort of clue to disqualify everything about a particular situation or a particular experience. Does that happen? Yes? No?
Yes.
Any quick sort of examples?
If somebody is telling you that your child has taken marks less,
then
the next exam may be less, but parents don't see that improvement has happened or not.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Great example. No? That one person behaves in a certain way, the next time might actually be much better version of his or her own behavior from the past. But then we are not able to give that adequate sort of benefit of doubt to the person because we have already generalized based on one instance, one behavior, what is generally the prediction or what is generally likely to be the reaction of another person or your own self as well. We take one single discomfort and try to sort of see everything through that lens of discomfort, right? That's one more. Next one. Minimization and magnifying the problem, right? Again, take one slightest discomfort, one slight disagreement in the team, and that it is magnified to the extent that you feel that itself defines the entire situation. Very simple thing again that happens, that somebody does something, one thing wrong, and you take that as the only outcome of that entire situation, right? So you magnify what is not right, what is wrong, and you discount or disqualify everything that is good about a particular situation. And honestly, there are very, very few situations in which there is practically nothing good at all. In almost every single situation, there is something that is evolving, something that is different, something that is sort of new. We often sort of blame ourselves saying something that I have told myself not to do it this so many times. I still keep doing the same thing again and again. Do we say this? We say this often, no? Like, kitni baar maine khud se bola hai ki aise to nahi karna hai, lekin I keep going back to doing the same thing again and again. Honestly, you never do the same thing again. You actually always do things differently because you're always a different person. Every day you're growing, so even by that logic itself, you're not going to do the same thing again ever. But then, there is this whole thing of you perfectionism. That's something that we chase. There is so much burden from outside. We have given some airs about expectations we have from ourselves, and out of that we tend to sort of start magnifying what is not right. Right? Okay, next one. Some random rules we have kept for ourselves. I must do this today, only then I am a good person. I must go and see this person today, if not I am a horrible friend. I should always be in time for Tarun, otherwise that person is not sincere. Or I should always stand up when somebody comes in, if not then I'm a disrespectful person. We actually, you know, just sort of, I'll send across all of this to you. One simple thing is to start just looking at our own reactions and you will actually realize that how many rules do we put onto ourselves almost on a daily basis, which A, don't make sense, B, do not actually add to anything to you actually feeling positive or feeling healthy, and 3, actually in fact are also capable of stopping the progress that you are doing in general and not letting you be. you're almost always trying to satisfy some rules that you yourself have created. Nobody has created them for you. Just think about it. Okay, last one. Personalization and sort of pointing fingers to yourself. So when I say pointing a finger, it's not to the others. Personalizing it, basically to the extent that you're just not able to see that a lot of situations do not have anything to do with you, right? They actually have zero resemblance or zero connection with how you are or what you are. It actually just sometimes things just happen. What we also call it is just world fallacy. Just world fallacy is basically that you feel that you are subject to injustice where you actually are not, right? So don't take it in any other context except for this. I'm not making a statement on justice in society, etc. I'm specifically saying that there will be so many, or there are so many situations which actually are just unfair, or they are just not comfortable. It has nothing to do with you, but you still sort of personalize it and take it on to yourself, right? So that's the other sort of cognitive error. Now, all of this put together is basically gives a simple sort of structure for us to think of what exactly stops us from making workplaces inclusive. How do we connect it all of this together, right? One is this, my entire take on how mental health is at workplace, etc. B is how much awareness we ourselves have of our mind and how much care we are taking of ourselves. How inclusive are we of our own feelings and emotions on a daily basis? That's the first question to ask to ourselves, right? It's an ongoing process. What we did here right now is a part of this entire cognitive behavioral therapy. This is perhaps just the starting step of it, where we are just identifying that a lot of our challenges, including what we feel with our team, with our colleagues, a lot of them actually can be tackled with just changing your response to it. That's the first belief. Second one is, for me, entire inclusion starts from A, acknowledging that what you're feeling is valid. You have a reason to feel it. Nothing is invalid. You might have a genuine challenge with behaving in a way that is, let's say, acceptable by the group or what is sort of considered approved by the group. Yet, you have the right to, you have the space to go and express, talk about it. And creating that space is something that lies with the organization, that individuals are able to seek explanation, sometimes to their own behaviors. Not everybody is absolutely always clear. This also happens a little bit more with people who have reporting managers, that we sometimes put the entire burden of being perfect, all that we ourselves are also struggling with, onto the manager. But assume, just understand that in a lot of situations, manager is nothing but a few perhaps titles in terms of degrees ahead of her name and maybe a few more years. That alone, neither of these two guarantee that the person is going to be more evolved than you are, right? Hence, also understanding that we are all learning and giving them that space to learn and also co-develop strategies to survive together and thrive together, rather than expecting that one person is going to show you the sort of light in a way, or one person is always going to be perfect, whereas you will follow the example. No, sometimes you have to actually also take charge of the situation and contribute to it, right? That's the third one. And the fourth one, which is most important for me, is that when I wear the therapist hat, but I have also worked so much in the development sector and continue doing this in the policy space, one of the most important factors for me is we do not talk about health until it becomes an illness. We talk about it almost on a daily basis. We are conscious about it in every choice we make. The food we eat, the kind of drinks that we take in, sometimes committing to exercise and doing exercise, for example. We go to the doctor only when there is a situation which we have not caused, which is just absolutely something that you cannot manage. Similarly, when we are talking about being inclusive, even with mental health, right, do not wait until it becomes a crisis to tackle it. It needs to become almost a part of our daily culture, daily organization behavior, where we have integrated human mind and the assumption it will operate in many different ways, it will emancipate in many different ways, and respecting it, making space for it on a daily basis. It's only when somebody is not able to cope up with, let's say, anxiety, pressure, depression, etc., is when you are reaching out for help outside. But it's not, and then we are saying, oh, it's okay to talk about mind, there is no stigma, there should not be any stigma. The thing is, we have so much daily stigma about our emotions and feelings that we suppress them almost on a daily basis, and then we say that let's talk about depression. But the thing is, how it accumulates over a period of time is by suppressing it in yourself every day, and to that extent also letting others suppress it. So actually create more and more platforms and spaces. Due to lack of time, we are not doing second part of this. There is a very small part that we would have done, but I'll just share it with you all on email. It's simply just also by learning to listen to people, how can we create that space? But in another session, we'll talk about it, or I can just share it with all of you. But very, very important, very important to sort of start talking about it in every single conversation. Let's not wait for organization head or HR head to create that space where there is a Friday platform, then you go and talk about emotions. Do your emotions stop until Friday? No. So there is no right day to talk about emotions, right? So actually making it, see, then questions come is like, oh, but in this moment we have a target and we don't have time to talk about emotions. Trust me, there is time to talk about emotions in every single situation. But we have to adopt that entire organization culture which is built towards it. Stress, particularly something that all of us are experiencing it every day. One very simple, and first of all, let's acknowledge that that stress is building from all sides. Trust me, I was just telling somebody the other day that earlier, the other day I just ordered something from Swiggy. Let's for the simplicity's sake, let's take it as I had ordered parathas and I had ordered lassi. Right, parathas arrived, lassi did not. Now in between, I rated the app, I rated the food, I rated the delivery person. Then I went to the customer care, I talked to one customer care person, rated her. She could not resolve my problem, then went to another, rated her. Still could not solve the problem. Then finally they put me in touch with the restaurant. Then I rated the conversation with the restaurant. Then finally after 2 hours, lassi arrived. Then I again rated the delivery, the restaurant, the food, everything. Your simple ordering food requires you to think about, oh, ye 5-star behavior tha ya 3-star tha, 2-star tha ya 1-star tha. How will stress not accumulate? It is obviously geared towards it. Every single situation, particularly in the urban life that we are living currently, we are consistently evaluating others, consistently evaluating ourselves. We have to operate through filters. Nothing goes in social media without a filter. And these are simple examples, right? We don't even have to look at big stressing events, the financial stress, or a whole bunch of other stresses that accumulate around us. So it's sort of an accumulation of all of this. And at a workplace, when we are talking about making it inclusive, it is humanly impossible to leave all the stress that we are experiencing in our daily lives outside and operate in a place where you are productive, you are forward-looking, you are mission-oriented, you are committed to the goal, you are committed to social well-being, you are committed to changing the world one person at a time, and plus you are sending your emails in time, sending your updates in time, you are also contributing to team building, you are also contributing to sometimes moving office furniture. All of this, you know, like if there was this mythological concept of Purna Purush, which was Ram, we are trying to be that almost on a daily basis. It did not exist in mythology, it does not exist in today's world. So it's an accumulation of all of this. At workplaces, we need to be just aware of this. Where it's possible, it's good to have that conversation around different emotions. Right? Okay? Yes. I will definitely stop. Okay, I'm going to stop here. Thank you so much for joining this. It's a little too much information packed in a little bit of little time, but yes.
How do we rewire our automatic thoughts and images? Is it just the awareness of this, or how do we do that? Is it possible?
How do we rewire our thoughts? I'm not actually going to answer this right now, but we have tea break, so we'll talk a little bit about it. There is no secret I'm going to tell him outside, by the way, just that the topic is long. One very simple thing, right? Basically, I have myself got into this entire sort of therapy work over the last 2-3 years, primarily after experiencing that workplaces with best intentions can be non-inclusive. So I'm not even coming from a place where places are quite non-inclusive, quite emotionally not nourishing, etc., which a lot of workplaces are. We tend to become people that we don't ourselves relate with at a workplace quite often. We see that. We behave very differently at workplace than elsewhere else. But that was one. Second is my own experiences throughout building over a period of several years through different sort of experiences in terms of just purely first as a queer person not being accepted in most spaces, particularly when I was growing up in smaller cities, smaller towns, having to sort of question yourself and justify yourself in a lot of situations. After that, moving to places where emotional stress is very high and how it emancipates. And then one option for me was to, one, of course, work on myself, which I did through an extensive therapy of almost 6 years. And then another 3 years in just learning what does it really sort of take to manage emotions of your own and helping others as well, right? And one sort of, there are beautiful sort of experiences in this entire journey. One is that just understanding that tremendous potential we hold to sort of actually take charge of our emotions and our feelings, and how much does it actually change the reality outside you. I can guarantee you that nothing became just suddenly and accommodating around me overnight. But there is definitely certain formula or a sort of mechanism. There is some sort of like a coping mechanism that I have sort of come up with, which we can live by. That was one. Second is also seeing that when people find access to the right tools to manage emotions and behave in the right way, the magic that it creates in their lives, which is not magic at all, it's just a matter of practice and reflection. That's second. And third is actually just this simple thing that what you have experienced, what you have learned, is something that you can pass on to the others, right? So that's where I'm coming from. So that's the end of today's talk. If you have anything to check, last minute thoughts, complaints, questions, criticism, star rating, please feel free to bring in. Yes?
Can you have a different narrative to the cognitive error thing?
Yes.
So these are simply cognitive blind spots, right?
Yes.
And so to me, they are like switches.
Yes.
So a switch, you turn it.
And switch on the light.
Switch, you turn it off, it's dark. But dark can't always be bad, right?
Right.
So when you were giving the examples, I was thinking that maybe I could use these to program my own mind.
Right.
And I was drawing connections between when the panelist shared in the last session, and the sir was sharing actually, that when he was threatened, when his life was being threatened, but he still had a call of duty to respond to.
Right.
Maybe he was using the same switches you mentioned, minimization, maxima, magnification, emotional urgency and all that, to actually act not in the way you'd want to respond, but the way in which you need to respond. So then these necessarily aren't all bad things, right? They can use to advantage as well.
Absolutely. Actually, very important disclaimer came towards the end of the session that we might be committing these errors. None of this makes us horrible people. None of this, if we are making every single of these errors on a daily basis, even then, there's just no sort of, there isn't anything wrong with it. The whole point with this is to actually start getting access to our mind, which we sometimes struggle to get, and just use this as pointers, rather than now making like a list of it and aaj ko to mujhe rate karna hi hai, 10 mein se kitne errors maine aaj kiye. Nothing like that. There is no. This is all coming from a place of sort of A, understanding your emotions better. And if you know them better, then you can manage them better. That's a simple place where it's coming from. So when it's presented to you as errors, all of us are committing this every day, A. And again, none of these errors are intentional. These are blind spots, as our friend said. These are absolutely blind spots, which we just sort of getting used to. And then we know how to navigate them sort of better. That's all that is there.
But my question was just, isn't our brain wired in a way, I might be wrong also, that if I know that I'm doing something wrong, maybe there's an error, maybe I'm doing something wrong, so I have to correct it. So wouldn't that be a conflict constantly in the mind?
If you start paying
emotional reasoning, like
you know, so that is one question I had in terms of even when I designed this session, that how much do we leave with just these, because this is almost handing over a critical mind more tools of criticism, right? So basically, how do we then sort of overcome these, or how do we manage this? I'll share some readings with you just in the interest of time. Don't want to overrun my schedule in front of punctual. Okay. One simple thing, right? Basically, thank you so much. No, so basically, we know this. These are not tools for microscopic sort of analysis of yourself every day. Right? So, subah uth gaye, fir dear diary. Aaj maine black and white thinking kiya, labeling kiya, judgment. Like, doesn't work like that, right? One simple thing is. What is the magic formula to change your thoughts or emotions or feelings, right? A is to become aware of them. Majority of the times, we are not aware of them. This simply gives us a method of inquiry into when there are certain behaviors which yourself are not happy with. First, ask yourself this question that, am I falling into any of these traps? A. We are just so allergic to looking at our own emotions. So first, acknowledging. Cut down all the noise that is there. Iska to jaake badla lunga hi, isko to main sikha kar hi aunga. Keep that all that aside and just take the sort of saying that every situation, it is what it is. Let me first just understand what is my response to it, where is it coming from. So use this as a tool to sort of understand emotions and do not label them. Right? That is one very fundamental thing. Second is, nobody. Of course, including myself, but anybody else outside this room also is never consistently error-free on all 10 parameters. In fact, the list itself is flawed because I'm going to give you a handout which has 15 errors, which doesn't have 10, right? So there are actually so many errors that keep happening all the time. You don't stop living and actually just start thinking in terms of leave it for others to do it for you. If you're finding your emotions overwhelming, where you're not able to make sense of them yourself, reach out for help. Talk to the person outside you, who doesn't have to be your therapist all the time. It could be simply a person who's available in your office. It could be anyone. Talk about them, get that external perspective. That is the simple one. But generally, over a period of time, observing and finding patterns, you will realize that you repeat these 10 errors, all of us do, but we also repeat them in certain situations more than in others. We all do not always do it. That's the second part of it. Actually, just creating some information-based point of references, data for yourself to sort of start changing some of your thoughts and behaviors. And the third one is similarly, do not use these as additional tools to judge others. Right? This is very important that now that you know the terms, तू तो ब्लैक एंड व्हाइट थिंकिंग कर रही है मुझे तो पता है तू तो फॉर्चून टेलिंग कर रहा है यू नो लाइक दैट्स वे द रियल सॉर्ट ऑफ ब्यूटी ऑफ इट गेट्स लॉस्ट समवेयर एंड व्हाट इज लेफ्ट इज एन अटेम्प्ट टू मेक इट इंक्लूसिव बिकम्स एक्चुअली अनदर टूल टू डिस्क्रिमिनेट विथ अदर्स राइट सो इट्स द टूल दैट यू कैन यूज इन बोथ वेज सो दैट्स अनदर इंपॉर्टेंट रिमाइंडर टू योरसेल्फ दैट सीक क्लैरिफिकेशन रादर देन अनाउंसिंग सॉर्ट ऑफ अ वर्डिक्ट दैट्स द अदर वन रिलेटेड टू दिस A lot of it is a part of what I have used today, is a part of two different approaches to therapy. One is called cognitive behavioral therapy, and the other one is called dialectical behavioral therapy. I have shared the sort of readings on both of these. Very simply, it's basically using a lot of behavioral psychology that existed until 70s, and then adding the entire aspect of mindfulness, a lot of Buddhism also involved in it. To arrive at this certain sort of way of treating patients with all sorts of psychological sort challenges, issues, illnesses, including anxiety, depression as the start of the spectrum, going to personality disorders. We use this as almost frontline therapies for that. And quite often what we see is that actually along with medication, using cognitive behavioral therapy, dialectical behavioral therapy actually becomes almost 100% more effective in particularly dealing with mental illnesses. So CBT is part of it. CBT is also something that is not a talk therapy which goes on, come and talk about all your past. It takes a lot of your beliefs and just builds upon that to help you develop a path for yourself, which is sort of more towards more sort of cognitively healthy behavior. And then the second part, dialectical behavioral therapy, is exclusively meant for people living with different personality disorders. So the entire value framework we took from in the start, I have actually borrowed it from dialectical behavioral therapy, where a person living with personality disorder, the main characteristic is that the person can actually have different thoughts, very legit thoughts about oneself in different situations, to the point that the person is not able to even tell how he or she is feeling. So in that, we do the entire core values session with the person to acknowledge that we are all trying to do better and it's okay to be in whichever place we are. We can start from there, right? So these are the two therapy approaches I have used. Both of these are mostly meant for individual work, but I have tried it doing it with the group today. I hope that this was useful for you. Maybe not the best perfect, but as I said, we are all trying to get better. And I hope that I have given you some new pointers to sort of all the efforts you are doing towards making your organizations more inclusive. I'll be more than happy to talk to you about this anytime again in the future. But thank you. Thank you for joining me. It's really, really nice. Yes, we are. I'm handing out. There are only 30 printouts here. So
two people, one copy.
If you can even just take a picture and share it with the other person.
It's just small.
Oh, thank you so much. Oh, thank you. This is very sweet. You have seen this. It's wonderful. Thank you.